Let's take you to my chat with the Anxiety Sisters. Now, am I allowed to say that I'm an anxiety sister too?
Oh, we hope you are.
Okay. I'm your sister in anxiety. And, you know, what I loved in, you know, reading your bio was that you two were anxious kids, anxious teenagers, anxious young adults.
Anxious middle-aged adults.
And now we're all anxious middle-aged adults. But at least now we've got some information and it's more normalized. We have the internet. But just like me, you all were figuring this out in a world where I don't even know if the word anxiety was being used. And I don't know if you're anything like me, but I thought you were either normal or crazy. And crazy meant you live in a padded room for the rest of your life and your family visits you once a year. And so I didn't want to tell anybody because I felt like it was like confessing to a murder. Like if I say something, then this whole thing's going down. You know, my life's changing forever. So can you take me through your lives together and why this is to me so unique is that you had each other and, you know, friendships grow apart all the time and that you both stayed anxious together, but helped each other through it. Can you tell me your story in your own words?
Well, we met in college in the late 80s. And so we say that although we're not biological sisters, we are definitely soul sisters. Because after 34 years of tolerating each other, we definitely have earned that. we're now linked forever. But I think that what attracted us to each other initially was just sort of that panicked expression we both wore on our faces all the time. And I think we felt like kindred spirits, right, Mags? I mean, isn't that sort of, I mean, I looked at her, you know, I listened to sort of the things that she talked about and I thought, yeah, I'm feeling that too. And she seems like the kind of person that I could confide in and tell her that, you know, I went to the counseling center and they were talking
to I laughed just because those were never helpful back then.
No, I felt like I didn't want to tell anyone I went to the counseling center because some people were like, oh, why? What's wrong with you? So I didn't want to tell anyone, but I felt like Maggie was someone I could tell. I don't know why. She just looked like someone who either had been to the counseling center herself or at least understood. And I said to her, have you gone to talk to anybody about this? And she was like, oh, yeah, it didn't really help. I was like, ah, thank goodness. So that's kind of how the conversation began. We lived in the same dorm and really ended up spending a lot of nights sitting together and talking about what ended up being our symptoms of anxiety and even some depression. We just didn't have the vocabulary for it back then. People weren't talking about it. I mean, I know I thought that there was just something physically wrong with me and that I'd probably die from it eventually. I just didn't know what it was. And Maggie thought she had some sort of stomach ailment that was most likely cancer or definitely fatal. And we kind of, you know, lamented the fact that we would have, you know, very anxious and short lives.
You know, I have the same thing, Abbe. I thought as well, you're reminding me that I didn't just think something might psychologically be wrong. I had panic disorder undiagnosed. And so I thought, oh, I just have a heart condition or something that we don't know what it is yet. But if I feel like this 10 times a day, every day, I'm probably not going to live very long. It's probably going to kill me.
We like to say that we had our 20s was our decade of the is. Where, you know, we still didn't really understand this idea of anxiety disorder. And we each sort of decided, okay, we're going to go see what is actually wrong with us. So we went to the nutritionist and the cardiologist and the hypnotist and the past life regressionist and the psychiatrist, the therapist, you know, whatever is there was. And whomever would take our money, we were there trying to find the reason why we felt like we felt.
We would go anywhere or do anything that offered some hope because we were both so, even though we had each other, we were very isolated and lonely because I think anxiety disorder does that. It makes you feel set apart from others. And we felt really alone. Like we thought we were the only two people that were dealing with this.
Yeah.
So, and we didn't have the internet back then, so we didn't have the access to other people saying, yeah, I experienced this also. And, you know, we tried to look for that and we couldn't find it. We went to the bookstore, you know, we're book people. So yeah. We went to the bookstore and thought, all right, we'll buy books about anxiety and that will make us feel better. And, you know, I had a full blown panic attack at Barnes and Noble. because the book that I pulled out, it had panic in the title and it was bright red. And do you remember that, Mags?
Yes, I do remember it.
I have to leave the store. I did, because I was starting to shake. And some of the books that we were reading, I mean, they were written by very respected experts who absolutely knew their stuff, but it was very clinical and very prescriptive. And all Mags and I kept saying to each other is, I don't think we can do this. I mean, one of the books that we read told me that I needed to do heavy cardiovascular exercise 30 minutes a day. Well, I gotta tell you something, in my panic, my heart raced to ridiculous levels and I was already sweaty. And I thought, I can't make my heart go any higher than this. You know, I'll just get on the elliptical and blow up.
Anxiety Bites will be right back after a quick little message from one of our sponsors.
Hi, I'm Elliot Kalin, comedian, author, history buff, and host of the Who Was podcast, a history quiz show based on the best-selling book series where kid contestants go toe-to-toe for a chance to win fantastic prizes. My co-host, B.
That's me.
And I ask the tough questions like,
would Mozart like TikTok?
But that's not all we talk about on the show.
Usually my signature look is bedhead.
All right, I like it.
I do gymnastics and I have 2 scars.
Are the scars from gymnastics or were you like wrestling dinosaurs and things like that?
I really like history. Even my mom says I know more than most adults do.
We've got fun games, silly songs.
And don't forget to mention our amazing guests.
It's me, Frida Kahlo. Bonjour, c'est moi, Marie Curie.
Hello, everyone. It's me, Aretha Franklin.
Listen to the Who Was podcast on the iHeartRadio app, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you get your podcasts.
It's the Who Was podcast, because it's time to play the Who Was podcast. Who Was?
Hey, it's Alec Baldwin. On this season of Here's the Thing, I speak with more actors, musicians, writers, policymakers, and so many other fascinating people, like comedian Tim Dillon.
I couldn't tell you my congressman. I know every maitre d' of every restaurant. I know who's working Craig's. I know who's working, you know, all the places I want to go. Who's at El Pasteo?
When I'm in town, you come with me. We're going to go to Craig's. Host of The Talk, Amanda Kloots.
I did Broadway for 17 years. When you do that, it kind of prepares you for anything in life.
And the multi-talented musician and actor, Stephen Van Zandt.
When it comes to performing, that's just like a vacation for me. You know, whether it's acting or whether it's being a rock star on stage, you know, that stuff is just nothing but fun for me. The real work is looking at a blank piece of paper and creating something from it, you know?
Listen to Here's the Thing on the iHeartRadio app, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you get your podcasts.
On Long Shot Season 2, Payback, legendary women's soccer coach Anson Dorrance told me there are players he is paid to coach.
Oh, what a finish by Jess McDonald!
And players he'd coach for free.
McDonald in the area, one touch! Oh my goodness!
But that he would pay to coach Jessica McDonald.
She's had some very difficult moments in her life, but there's something inside the great athletes that is why they're great.
On Payback, the Charlotte Observer, Raleigh News and Observer, McClatchy Studios, and iHeartRadio share her story.
I ran away from home when I was 17 years old.
My recollections are mostly trying to find her.
Thank God for sports. That was my escape. And then I find out I'm pregnant with my son.
An incredible journey to the pinnacle of sports.
I was making $13K. I couldn't afford childcare.
McDonald, first start for the U.S. Women's National Team. How about that?
Payback. Available now on the iHeartRadio app, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you get your podcasts.
The whole stadium sharing equal pay.
Equal pay.
That's a movement.
So when you all are sitting around talking about your anxiety, and again, there aren't these words for it per se, what kind of things you're saying when you're talking about your symptoms with each other? Like, what words were you using?
Well, at different times it was different as we went along, but I think, you know, for us, there were some things happening in our lives that just indicated a problem, but we didn't really connect the dots in each of us had that. you know, or we didn't even know that it wasn't quite typical to, I don't know, you know, so I had developed at one point a lot of phobias. I knew that wasn't typical, but I didn't know the word phobia or exposure therapy, that type of thing. But I knew, oh God, when I'm driving in a car, I'm getting more and more nervous, and I can't drive in the rain. I have to pull over when it's raining.
Yeah.
Or I remember visiting Abbe at her grandmother's. We must have been, you know, in our early 20s, and she lived about an hour and a half away from where my parents lived, and I had taken their car. And that trip took me 6 hours because I kept having to pull over. And yeah. So, you know, I think a lot of times, and Abbe has her own version of that too, but I think a lot of times things were happening to us and we weren't quite connecting the dots, but, yep. You know, so it was more like, wait, why is that taking me 6 hours?
For me, the symptoms were so pronounced. And, you know, in your 20s, you're just not expecting to have chest pain all the time. You're not expecting to be dizzy, and you're not expecting for your left arm to suddenly go numb. You know, it's like I would watch these Bayer aspirin commercials and be like, oh my God, I'm dying.
Oh, the Bayer aspirin commercials, totally. That was about the only thing that seemed close to what yes. I was experiencing. So I remember buying Bayer aspirin in my 20s.
Yes. My conversations with Maggie would go something like this. She'd pick up the phone and she would say hello. And I would say, okay, it's happening again. My arm is numb. What do you think that could mean? It has to be heart attack, right? It has to be a heart disease thing. And she would say, well, yeah, but it's been going on for so long. I'm like, yeah, but what else could it be? And so a lot of our conversations were, well, what could this be? We don't get it. And then I went to the emergency room. Not once, not twice, not three times, but four times. And in the fourth time, I actually said, haven't you seen House? Look further. This is a real problem. You guys are missing it. You don't know. And he said, well, we did the EKG twice. We checked your enzymes. You've done a chest x-ray. We really can't do anything else. Your heart is totally fine. I'm like, you people do not know what you're doing because I'm in here every week.
And they didn't say anything like, gee, this could be anxiety.
Well, on the fourth go around, he said to me, this is definitely anxiety, and I'm going to prove it to you. He said, I have here a shot of Ativan. He said, which is a sedative. If you're having a heart attack, it's not going to stop your heart attack, he said. But if you're having anxiety, you should feel a little better. So he put it into my IV, and within 10 minutes, I'm like, this stuff is great. How do I get me some of this?
That is, you know, I've never heard anyone, I've heard of people being told by their doctor, you know, this is anxiety, when it was. But wow, what an amazing actual procedure that he gave you, which is, I'm going to give you an anxiety medication. You know, I mean, that's brilliant. I've never heard of that happening to anybody.
Well, he was the first person who made me think, all right, it's possible that these sharp chest pains, that the shortness of breath, that all these things that sound to me like a heart attack, maybe it's possible that this is coming from a different place. Maybe this is something in my brain.
It's interesting though, because as women, as you know, it dates back to the beginning of medicine. We were called hysterical if anything was ever wrong physically. You know, science still knows so little about women's bodies and women's health that it all boils down to we're hysterical, we're crazy. And yet, weirdly, so many women I know, when they have gone to get their heart tested or get a stress test or see a cardiologist, that actually anxiety comes up on like the third visit. And it's like, of all the times that someone should be saying, this actually is in your head, it sometimes doesn't seem to happen. And I know for me, a doctor once said to me, I mean, a therapist once said to me, for sure, go get all of your blood tests, go to the doctor and make sure nothing physical is wrong. And, you know, we can assume this is anxiety, but let's just make sure. And so I think that's always the best way to go. So in a weird way, people with anxiety end up doing the right thing first in a strange way.
Oh, we tell everybody, if you are an anxiety sister, you've probably seen cardiologists, neurologists, gastroenterologists. You know, you've seen probably, in some sense, you've seen like so many doctors and gotten things checked out. And we always tell people to do that, you know, because that is responsible.
Yeah.
because these symptoms are so physical, it's like people think, oh, anxiety. Oh, I feel a little anxious. No, it's not. You may not think, you know, I know I never felt like, oh, I'm anxious. I felt like, oh, I'm nauseous all the time. Oh, I can't eat. Oh, nothing's staying down. You know, so how is that anxiety? How is that not something wrong with my stomach? You know, and that's what's so tricky about anxiety is it's not a feeling. It's physical symptoms often.
Maggie, you're making me realize that, you know, in a weird way, you two were really lucky to not have language yet, because nowadays it can get so sanitized. So I'm thinking of your story where you're driving and it's raining. It takes you 6 hours. You have to pull over. You know, nowadays you might say to someone, I'm feeling some feelings of unreality. I'm having anxiety driving. And it just sort of gets washed over. And so what I'm experiencing a lot doing this podcast is people are writing to me and saying, now I don't have anxiety, but I have. And then they list 95 symptoms of anxiety, but none of the symptoms seem typical. So they don't think they have it. And so in a weird way, it's kind of a gift that we grew up learning to describe each and every symptom. My arm feels numb. I just have this feeling I can't complete the drive. So in a way, we were all really lucky because we are experts in knowing that anxiety is one word for a billion different things. And we have an easy acceptance now that, oh, this could be anxiety. We don't question it and say, how could that be anxiety? We did it first. But a lot of people I know that are pretty savvy about anxiety are kind of going backwards. They're still learning all of the symptoms, but they know the word.
Anything your body can do, any sound it can make, any smell, any fluid it can produce, anything your body can do, any organ, that something can happen during anxiety with that particular body part. In other words, if your body can do it, it can be a symptom of anxiety. And, you know, we have a really large virtual community in Anxiety Sisterhood, and a lot of our people are telling us all the time, really, this is really anxiety? So I think there's still quite a lot of people who don't believe their symptoms.
Can I ask you then, what was both of your first moments when you realized, oh, this is anxiety and anxiety disorder. Now I'm on the path.
Well, one thing I have to say is that is for many of us. And we, like Abbe said, we have this community of over 200,000 people who talk to us constantly. And I have to say that that's usually a process. You know, of someone saying to you, you have anxiety, and then you still can't really believe it, because who can believe these unbelievable physical symptoms, these debilitating symptoms?
Yeah.
So, but the first time, believe it or not, that I thought, I had a therapist telling me, you have anxiety, but I was like, she doesn't know what she's talking about, because these symptoms can't be anxiety. But I called, I was actually babysitting for my brother's son at the time, and someone, and my sister-in-law's sister called, and she said, how are you? And I don't know why I didn't say fine. I said, well, actually, I'm nauseous all the time. I can't eat. I was living in New York City at the time. I'm afraid of the subway. I'm afraid of my elevator and my building. I can barely get to work. I don't know why I just like spit all this out, right? And she said, yeah, I had that when I had agoraphobia. You have anxiety. And when she said it to me, not a therapist, not a doctor, but a peer said it to me, I was like, oh, she's telling me how she felt too. And somehow that turned a light on for me. We hear from a lot of people with agoraphobia, and I certainly had a case of it, you know, and Abbe went through periods of time with it. But, you know, people think it's like, oh, they're afraid to leave the house. That's not really agoraphobia. Agoraphobia is really fear of having a panic attack when you're outside the house and not being able to get home, or fear of, for some people, getting very sick outside the home and not being able to get home. So it really is agoraphobia when there are all these places. It starts often with transportation, but there are all these places that you can't go. And we have a term we like to use called shrinking world syndrome. So
I love that.
Yes. So even if it's not quite agoraphobia, even if you're sort of don't quite meet that diagnosis, as soon as we say, as soon as you're in the situation where your anxiety is making decisions about where you go, what you do, who you see, rather than yourself, you know, it's like these are anxiety decisions, then you're starting to have this thing we call shrinking world syndrome.
I think the misunderstood thing about agoraphobia and what you call shrinking world syndrome, it's not, I'm an introvert, or, you know, it's not that. It's like desperately really wanting to do these things and really thinking you can't. It's like if you thought you had a broken leg and you didn't, you know.
That's a perfect example in that it, you know, one of the things we try to do, Abbe really knows a ton about neuroscience and she's taught me a lot about it. But one of the things we really try to do is sort of break it down to the simplest neuroscience we could give people, right? Because you start to realize it is like a broken leg, but it's happening, you know, you have this trigger happy amygdala.
Yeah.
It is happening in a place in your body. It is something going wonky or not working in a way that's going to benefit you.
Yeah, it's real. And Abbe, what was your first, okay, this is anxiety, now I'm on the path? Or I know it's hard to say because it is a series of moments, but
I don't know if I ever got to that place because there's still days, you know, even now after I'm a bona fide anxiety sister and we've made our life's work to help people manage their anxiety so it doesn't manage them, even at that point, there's still some days where I'll call Mags and I'll say, are you sure this is anxiety? There was never one particular day. I certainly, when that ER doc gave me the Ativan, you know, I have a science mind, so that was fairly, okay, that makes sense to me. That's logical. And I liked that and that helped. And that was when I started to see my first psychiatrist. But then I spent a lot of years grappling, you know? And, you know, now I manage my anxiety really well. And I think I live a really full life despite having anxiety, but I still have it.
We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Katie Lowes. You might also know me as Quinn Perkins from Scandal or Rachel from Inventing Anna. I'm also a mother to my son, Albie, and my daughter, Vera. I wanted to create a space for open and honest conversations about all things parenting. And I thought a podcast was the best way to do just that. Check out season 5 of my podcast, Katie's Crib. It is super raw, vulnerable, and hilarious. Katie's Crib in no way, shape, form is judgmental or telling you exactly how to parent or exactly how you should be. I think it really just makes you feel less alone and gives you a community. We're going deep with guests like Inventing Anna's Anna Klumsky, How to Get Away with Murders, Asian Naomi King. And yes, sometimes my son Albie when he bursts into my studio, so that's cool. Listen to Katie's Crib every Thursday on the iHeartRadio app, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you get your podcasts.
From Cavalry Audio, the studio that brought you The Devil Within and The Shadow Girls, comes a new true crime podcast, The Pink Moon Murders.
The local sheriff believes there may be more than one killer. It's been 4 days since those bodies were found, and there's no arrest as of this morning.
They were afraid, especially out in that area. What if they come back or whatever?
It scared me to death. Like, it scared me. I was very, very intimidated to live here.
Crazy to think you go to sleep one night, maybe snuggling with your loved one, and never wake up. Or maybe you wake up in a struggle for your life, which you lose.
Join host David Ratterman as he explores one fateful night when evil descended upon small-town Ohio.
Killed 8 members of an Ohio family in a pre-planned execution.
A family was targeted, most of them targeted while they were sleeping.
Follow the Pink Moon Murders on the iHeartRadio app, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you get your podcasts.
I am Eva Longoria, and I am so excited to share my new podcast with you. It's called Connections with me, Eva Longoria. Now, you may know me as an actress, producer, director, humanitarian, and now I'm adding podcaster to the list. You know, over the last couple of years, I feel like we've lost so many connections, and everyone's talking about going back to normal. Well, I don't want to go back to normal. I want to connect better. I'm talking to the smartest people I know, friends and experts in all different categories, to talk about our most important connections and how to make them stronger. How should we connect with our partners, our kids, money, politics, food, jobs, news, spirituality, sex? How can we connect better with ourselves? Listen to Connections with Eva Longoria as part of the My Cultura podcast network, available on the iHeartRadio app, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you get your podcasts.
You guys mentioned your online community. Can you tell me, you know, in some detail what exactly that entails? So are people able to, talk with you? Is it a message board? What is this amazing community? Because I'm sure my listeners would like to be part of it.
Well, they can, and it's totally free. So they can come to our website, which is anxietysisters.com, and they can just, if you give us your email address, then you sign up for our newsletter and you get a free progressive muscle relaxation. And it really connects you with the community. And then also our Facebook page has become really, we had forums on our website and those were fine and people were chatting. And then suddenly people would be like, let's take this to FB. Mm. And everything was FB. And then before we knew it, everyone had kind of left the forums and gone to talk on Facebook. So our Facebook page is extremely active. I mean, Mags is on it all day long. We moderate everything. And we have one of the kindest, most supportive, gentlest pages I've ever seen. It's amazing to me how little discord there is with so many followers.
It's nice to hear a good Facebook story for once.
I mean, it's a really active page, and we, Mags and I, answer every private message and every email we get. So nowadays, with such big numbers, it takes a few days for us to get back to everybody, but we talk to hundreds of people a week.
Oh, you're saints.
Well, we have a book group on Facebook Live on Tuesday nights at 7 o'clock right now from our book, which is the Anxiety Sisters Survival Guide. And we do a chapter a week and we give a presentation basically based on that chapter. And then we also have one thing, which there is a small fee for it, but we have a 6-week, very private, very closed group on Zoom called the Coping Crew. That has its own Facebook page. So it's like most of our stuff is free. There's a couple of things that if you want sort of a higher level of interaction.
But it's completely free to talk to us.
That's so great.
Well, it's a great way to sort of learn so much, you know, from each other. And, you know, we have a real sort of ethnography of the anxiety experience, everything from OCD, you know, to panic disorder and intrusive thoughts and anything you can imagine. We've heard about, talked to someone with it.
You mentioned progressive muscle relaxation, and I so rarely get to talk to people about this. So I'm so glad you mentioned it. It wasn't in my plan, but I would love to chat about it. My first foray into getting help was when I was 21, and I found progressive muscle relaxation to be the most incredible tool that I still use to this day. And it's really good for the person as well who doesn't want to meditate or doesn't even want to think too much about, is this anxiety, is this not, you know, in quotes, normal people can do it. So this man in the 30s, when, you know, culture was changing and people were becoming kind of work addicted. So life was just work. And then you go drink after, and that's how you blow off steam. Oh, Edmund Jacobson. Hmm. He's the father of progressive muscle relaxation. Wow. And he wrote a book in the 30s called You Must Relax, Practical Methods for Reducing the Tensions of Modern Living. And in the 30s, people kind of poo-pooed him. And obviously his work got validated, you know, later on. But he was, they think of him as, he said, it describes exercises for relieving the tensions that precipitate heart attacks, high blood pressure, indigestion, ulcers, and other disorders. And I'm not